Welcome back. Our next speaker is Ralph Eckhart, or that 365 dude. As a cloud architect for peopleware, Ralph focuses on Microsoft 365 and the modern workplace. Ralph will walk us through the 10 most important things to consider when implementing conditional access.
Hi, thanks for the warm welcome, and happy to be here in the virtual Azure Community Day. And like you said, I'll be talking about the 10 tips on securing your company using conditional access. For me, it's not some sort of best practices thing. It's not an all deep technical session, but I want to look at the things we picked up implementing conditional access along the way with our customers. And share some tips that we encountered so that everyone can make the best out of their implementation. Quick word ahead, who am I? My name is Ralph. I work for peopleware as a cloud architect in the Netherlands, and I focus mainly on Microsoft 365 and modern workplace stuff. You can look me up online, 365dude.nl, twitter.com, or on LinkedIn. So if you encounter any questions during the session, please feel free to hit me up. Something I need to mention before I go ahead, I work for peopleware, but not since the end of last year, because peopleware was acquired by Proact, so I should call it Proact by now, but I just didn't have the chance to update my slides yet. So let's have a look at conditional access. What is conditional access? Conditional access is a way to improve your security by evaluating some conditions when logging on to your cloud suite, be it Office 365, be it the Azure portal, to evaluate all those conditions and apply specific controls to your sign-in. So these conditions can be anything like what sort of device are you using to log on, what is your current role in Active Directory and Azure Active Directory, what client app are you trying to use, from which location are you logging on, and all that conditions get thrown into a blender and evaluate it based on some rules you set beforehand, based on some machine learning on the Microsoft side. And in the end, based on that sign-in, certain controls will be applied. So you can allow access or block access to specific resources or provide access in a limited way so you can't copy and paste certain data out of your environment. You can require multi-factor authentication when signing in. Or you can force someone to reset their password if a sign-in is not trusted and you expect the account to be breached. All that sort of stuff can be done when signing into Azure Active Directory. And by that, to all the applications that use Azure Active Directory for sign-in. So that can be some on-premises applications that you use through the application load balancer or cloud applications. You integrate with Azure AD. So it can be third-party applications too. So basically, when you look at the conditional access, it's this guy stating you can't get through or you can. So I wrote up some quick tips on conditional access, 10 to be precise, things we picked up along the way when we implement conditional access for our customers, and I'll try to explain them step by step. So first of all, you can use conditional access to enforce multi-factor authentication. How can you do that? Let me switch over to my Azure portal. Basically, normally when you apply multi-factor authentication to specific users, you go into Azure Active Directory, you look up the user, and you enable multi-factor authentication by hitting the checkbox. When you do it through conditional access, you have some extra functionality which makes sure that conditional access is always, or multi-factor authentication is always being applied. So when a new account is provisioned, you don't need someone to actually check the box to apply multi-factor authentication. It's always there. So we set up a new policy. One of the things I call a best practice is to use a numeric value at the start of your policy name. Why? Because you can easily find back the policy and you can use it in troubleshooting so you can quickly find the right policy you're referring to. So in this case, I'll apply it to all users. Because I do that, I get a little notification window stating, well, be careful, don't lock yourself out. This policy affects all of your users. So if you apply this to, for example, an administrative account, and there is a situation with the Azure Multifactor Authentication Service, your administrative account is affected too. So you can't log on, you can't change MFA settings. So be careful when doing this. Somewhere along the way of my 10 tips, I'll look into creating a break glass account so you can work around this this issue. The next step in the conditions for multifactor authentication or for conditional access in general is specifying which cloud apps you would like to apply a policy to. I'll select the new preview Office 365 application. It's in preview, but this application contains all the applications in the Office 365 suite. So when you use this application, you won't need to specify all Office 365 components separately. There are specific conditions you can use when targeting specific sign-ins. I won't go into that now, right now, but further along in my presentation, I'll just go and skip to the access controls. And what I want to do is I want to grant access to this application, but require multi-factor authentication. You can check multiple boxes here. You can check for compliant devices or for protection policies being applied. And with the little radio box in the bottom of the screen, you can check if you want all of the access policies to be applied or just one of them. So you can grant access, for example, to a compliant device or require multi-factor authentication when a device is not compliant, or you can want them both active. Once that is done, I can simply apply the policy. And multi-factor authentication will be required for all users signing into Office 365. It's as simple as that. Once you've done this, you've enabled it for all users in your organization. So, and every time you create a new user, this policy is automatically applied and checked every time someone tries to log on to Office 365. In some situations, you don't want multi-factor authentication to be applied every time a user signs on. For example, if someone signs on from inside your corporate network, you might say, well, he's on this network. I trust his network. So I trust his user because he's on it. I don't want to apply that MFA. You can do that in conditional access by specifying named locations. I'll drop back to the Azure portal. And this is my conditional access blade. And I can go to the named locations blade and I can specify a location here. And I have one already specified. That's my VM in Azure. In this case, it's just a simple /32 IP address, but you can specify the public IP address of your company, for example, your office location by NetBlock. Or you can specify locations using specific countries or regions. So when creating conditional access policy, you might want to block access to specific information from abroad, from Russia or from China or whatever. You can use the country or region in this named location setting to block those countries. You can mark a location like I do here as a trusted location. I'll save the setting. And now I have this named location called Demo Azure VM, and I can use that in my conditional access policy. So for example, if I look at my require MFA for Teams policy, I have a policy set up which applies to all users. It applies specifically to the Microsoft Teams application. And for locations, I want this policy to apply to all locations used when signing in, but excluding the named location I just created. So this way, when I sign into Microsoft Teams, and I'll check the access control, when I sign into Microsoft Teams, multi-factor authentication is required, except when you log on from a named location, like the one I just specified. So let's check that. teams.microsoft.com. I'll sign in with my demo account. MFA is required. I get a push message on my phone, which you can't hear because, of course, I have it set to do not disturb. And I'm signed in. So based on the policy we just created, we just checked, MFA is required to sign into Teams. And you see, it indeed requires me to use the MFA, the multi-factor authentication app, to complete my sign-in. Well, now I switch back to a VM I have in Azure. Let me check what my IP is. This is the IP we just saw in the named locations tab. I'll sign in with the same demo account. And I'm signed into the Teams application without needing to perform a multi-factor authentication because I'm on the named location we just created. So if you use this, for example, to specify your corporate IP addresses, you can exclude people from inside your office to perform multi-factor authentication because you already trust the network and you don't need them to do any more sign-in options. What comes with that is that you don't only exclude them from doing multi-factor authentication, but when you set up MFA using conditional access, people are prompted to configure their multi-factor authentication app the first time they actually hit the policy. So the first time they sign into Office or when they enroll their device or whatever, they get prompted to register for multi-factor authentication and set up their app on their phone or their phone number for the text messages. That can be a security risk. Why? For example, you have someone working in finance in your company and she only works from the office. She just steps in the train every morning, drives to the office, goes sit behind the PC and does her job. That means that because she's never actually targeted by the policy, because she's always from inside the corporate location, she never gets prompted to set up multi-factor authentication. Now, when the account gets breached and someone has the credentials and tries to log in impersonating this user, the attacker will be the first to actually be hit by the conditional access policy and be prompted to set up MFA. So there goes your security. The attacker is the first one to set up MFA and can just use MFA to gain access. So what you might want to do is block multi-factor authentication enrollment for connections originating from outside your corporate location. And we can do that using the same named locations we just saw in the Azure portal, but with a specific conditional access policy. I'll come back to my policies. And I've already set it up here, block MFA enrollment from outside. Again, we apply this policy to all users. In this case, we excluded the administrative account. And instead of specifying a cloud application for this policy, we specify a user action. And in this case, it's user action register security information. As a condition, again, in this case, we set it to apply to all locations and exclude all trusted locations. And we grant access, but we require multi-factor authentication. So when a user tries to set up their security information, aka.ms/mfa-setup, and they haven't already specified their MFA settings, they can only change that doing multi-factor authentication when coming from outside the office. So once I click through, and I need to sign in again. When I'm from outside the office, I will be prompted to do multi-factor authentication, but multi-factor authentication hasn't been set up yet, so I can't. I will be denied access. But when I'm from inside the corporate office, the policy won't be applied. So I can just sign in and set up my multi-factor authentication app. This way you can block MFA enrollment for connections coming from outside your office. And you will be more secure because when supplying their security information, you will know people will do that, at least the first time they do it, from a secure location, in this case, being your corporate office. One of the next tips I have, and it's more of a general tip, applying to everything you do in the Microsoft world, be it Active Directory, Azure Active Directory, or conditional access, is exclude users based on group membership. We just saw some policies. In one of them, I had the administrative account as an exclusion for the users. I usually don't exclude users based on a user level. I exclude them based on group membership. Why? Because it's much easier to maintain, and it's much more visible to see which users are being applied a policy or not, or which users are being excluded by a specific policy. So that's more of a basic tip on designing your conditional access policies. Tip number five is make your policies as fine-grained as possible. So when you design your policies, use policies for every single application. Do not combine apps in a policy, because this way you can easily make exclusions or create extra security per application. So if I go back to my portal, let me check this one. This policy is specifically targeted to Microsoft Teams. Like I said in one of the earlier demos, you can now use the Office 365 application to target all Office 365 applications at once. You can do that because most of those applications are always combined in a single policy. Because if you use Microsoft Teams, for example, you also use SharePoint, you also use OneDrive, you need to have calendar access through Exchange Online. So all those applications are being used in one single point of view. But for all other applications, third-party apps, Salesforce, or every app that uses SAML or OAuth to authenticate to Azure Active Directory, split them up in different policies. Because you might want to be able to create an exclusion for app A that doesn't apply to application B. And by splitting up those applications in several policies, you have the ability to do so. So that's one of the tips I can give. Make your policies as fine-grained as possible. Tip number six is not directly a conditional access tip, but more an Azure AD tip or a security tip in general. Configure your company branding in Azure AD. Why? You will see it every time you log on, even if, for example, a conditional access policy is not being applied. I'll go back to this one and sign out for a bit. And one of the major advantages, in my opinion, of using a branding in Azure AD is that it makes sure that your user knows which tenant he's logging onto. So you can see the branding here. I'm signing into the Contoso demo account. And the background image is being changed with the windmills from the standard background image. And by all those different icons and labels, as a user, I can actually check which tenant I'm logging on to. So I am sure that I'm not being redirected to some phishing site because my corporate logo is on here, because the background is what I expect. So that's a bit of security. On the other hand, if you enroll users to multi-factor authentication or you start using conditional access, a lot of work goes into the user adoption part. You need to tell your users to enroll in MFA. You need to tell them what to expect when they log on from an untrusted computer, for example. And in my opinion, it's best to do so using branded screenshots from the screens they're going to see when, for example, enrolling in MFA. If you don't use branding and you use just some specific image, people will get lost and they won't be able to complete the instruction. They won't be able to set up their MFA account, for example. Now, when we're talking modern workplace with our users, we talk about managed devices and managed apps, for example, for accessing Exchange, mobile device management and mobile application management. We manage the entire device. We can wipe the entire device as a company, or we manage just a specific app, Outlook, for example, which people use to connect to Exchange online. So when they lose their device, we can wipe the corporate data. Or when they leave the company, we can wipe the corporate data without wiping the entire device because it's, for example, a bring your own device. So you might want to be sure that when people are accessing your data, they are using either a managed device or a managed application. And there won't be another way to access the data in your corporation, just to make sure that your data stays inside your company and there is no possible data leakage. You can do that using conditional access with a specific conditional access policy. So I'll call it require management. Again, in this case, I'll set it up for all users. And well, let's use the Office 365 application, because I want this policy to apply to all my corporate data living in Office 365. I won't specify any specific conditions in this case, because I want it to apply anytime, not just from specific locations. And I want to grant access, but I'll need to require a device that's marked as compliant. So it is enrolled in Intune. We check the device and we know it meets our compliance policies. For example, on encryption or password usage, it's a managed device. So we're doing MDM. Or I want an app protection policy to be applied. For example, on Outlook, I want to apply certain policies that keeps our data inside the Outlook app. And people won't be able to copy those emails to a different application. So in this case, I checked two controls, and I'll check the require one of the selected controls. So the evaluation will be done with an OR method. I require a device to be marked as compliant, or I will require an app protection policy. So if you don't use a compliant device, or if you don't use an app protection policy on your application, you can't access corporate data. And this way you can make sure that when people sign in, they do so in a manner that's supported by your organization and that's controlled by your organization. Tip number 8, configure risk-based conditional access. So when we look at managed devices, we evaluate specific settings on the device or on the sign-in action, and we can use those evaluations within our conditional access policies. And it's in the conditions tab. We can check on the device state. So is the device state marked as compliant, for example, or is it a hybrid ICRD joint device? But we can also look at the sign-in risk, and that's something that Azure AD evaluates on the backend. On each sign-in, they will check the risk of that sign-in. So is it a device that's not fully up-to-date, not patched? Is the antivirus software or the firewall running or not? What's the location you're signing in from? And is it a location that we've seen before or is it a new location? And based on that information, Azure AD will mark the sign-in risk on a sign-in. And you can use that information in your conditional access policy. So this way you can block high-risk sign-ins or require extra security measures, for example, on a medium-risk sign-in. So I want all my sign-ins to be allowed, but if it's detected as a medium risk, I want to apply multi-factor authentication. And this way you can control all the sign-in options going in and out of your organization through conditional access in a very fine-grained manner. So you can make sure all those sign-ins are evaluated. Tip number 9, I think it's one of the most important tips. Learn how to troubleshoot sign-in and conditional access. Conditional access is applied after signing in to your account. And I'll go into the Azure AD blade for this one. And I just signed in as Megan. And on the left hand, you can see your sign-ins for this account. And these were my previous sign-ins from this account, which I just demoed a few minutes ago. And you can click open those sign-ins. And you can see all the information on this particular sign-in. And in the conditional access tab, you can see which conditional access policies were being applied when signing in. So this way you can look and see if the policies are being applied the way you designed them. You can set a conditional access policy to not be applied, but to the report only mode. And that way you can see them right here. So you can see if the policy would have been applied if it was turned on. But the most important thing to know is that these policies are being applied after signing in. So first it checks for your username and your password, checks your credentials, and once those have been validated, conditional access will be applied. So for example, one of the previous projects I did was rolling out mobile device management in the company. So we instructed all those users to go to the App Store from Apple and download the company portal application to enroll their device to Intune. It turns out if you go into the App Store and you search for a specific application, the first one that pops up, the top one, is always a sponsored ad. So if you go into the App Store for Intune and you search for the company portal, the first result you will get is not the actual Microsoft company portal. A Microsoft company portal will be the second result returned. The first one is just some sponsored ad. So there were users who downloaded the wrong app because they thought, oh, well, I searched for the company portal. I've downloaded it because it's the top result. It should be the best one. But I can't enroll my device to Intune. Well, then if you go for the specific sign-ins for that user and you search for the sign-in using the company portal, you won't see it here, because the credentials that have been entered aren't validated against Azure Active Directory, but they're being validated against that specific app you downloaded. So you won't see them at all in your Azure AD sign-in logs, and that way you can find out if they followed the entire procedure the right way, or they messed up somewhere and they are signing into the wrong application. Of course, once you discover that, you'll need them to reset their password because, well, you don't know where they entered it. So that's one thing. The second thing, when you sign in using conditional access, like I said, first the credentials are evaluated and then the conditional access policy will be applied. So if you have a conditional access policy that blocks certain browser agents, for example, you will see the sign-in screen. You will be able to enter your username and your password. And only after that, the conditional access policy blocking that specific browser will be applied. Furthermore, if you use conditional access to block specific browser agents, for example, it looks at the browser agent inside the header you sent when signing in or when accessing the web page. So you could change that header. You could use your developer tools within your browser to change the user header or the browser agent header in your sign-in request, so you can bypass conditional access that way. It's an important thing to know. One of the best practices, I think, for hash rating in general, but also for conditional access, is to set up Azure AD to send their logs to a log analytics account. Because basically in Azure AD, you get a retention of, I believe, 14 days on your sign-in events. When you send them to a log analytics account, you will be able to store them indefinitely. You can send them to a storage account, and you will be able to store those sign-in events indefinitely. And you will be able to do some further intelligence on those sign-ins. Check, for example, relations between sign-ins or trends when signing into specific applications, and if they're being used more or less over a certain period of time. So I've talked about this one before, creating a break glass account. I think it's an important thing to do in your organization to be able to always get access to specific parts of the Azure portal or your administrative environment. It's a bit hard to show in this tenant because I haven't got an active subscription here. It's a demo tenant. But what you basically do is set up your Azure AD logs to be sent to a log analytics account. And on your log analytics account, you create a search query that checks for sign-ins from this specific account. And you can add an alert to it so that when the account is being used for a sign-in action, you'll be prompted an email or a notification on your Azure app on your smartphone that there is action from this account. Exclude this account from all your conditional access policies, create a strong password for it, auto-generate it, and put it in a safe somewhere. Don't use that account on a day-to-day basis, but use it only in case of emergency. In case of emergency, break glass, hence the name of the account. That way you will always have access to the Azure portal or your administrative settings. We've seen some situations, I believe it was last year, when there was a major disturbance in the Azure MFA service where multi-factor authentication couldn't be applied. That's a problem. If you require MFA for all your accounts, you won't be able to, for example, temporarily disable multi-factor authentication for your users because you can't sign in yourself. And when setting up a break glass account, you always have access to the administrative portal and you can always make the changes you need to make to make sure you can do what you need to do. So those were 10 basic tips on conditional access and the way we like to set things up. I'm pretty quick today, I see. It's only 3:30. But I can check to see if there are any questions in our chat on YouTube. And I don't know if you have any questions.
There are a few, actually. There's been quite some action, so I have to scroll back a bit. But I think there's one by Vanopsis. Says, can you target only Dynamics 365? With a multi-factor authentication enforcement policy? It's the first question.
I believe you can. Let me check. So I'll check one of my existing policies and select a cloud app. Yeah. Doesn't look like it. No, I can't select Dynamics or CRM as an app in my conditional access settings. So I guess the answer is no.
All right. Next question by Remco. When you select all users must use MFA, does that also apply to delegate partners?
It depends on the way you delegate access. But if you look at B2B collaboration and you use that for delegation, then no, because sign-ins for those delegate partners are done against the Azure Active Directory for their tenant. So if you would require them to be using MFA, you would require them to use MFA within their own tenant. Sign-ins for delegate partners that are signing in against their own Azure Active Directory won't hit your Azure Active Directory for authentication and authorization.
Cool, then Wesley has quite a lot. Oh, he has two questions actually. User sits on couch and blindly approves MFA on phone. Obviously, the user didn't try to log in but approved regardless. Result, dumpster fire. Can you block logins when the originating login is from a different country than the device approving the MFA?
No. It doesn't check for IP addresses origin or origin for the Authenticator app. First of all, the Authenticator app isn't the only way to do multi-factor authentication. You can use a token one-time password from within your app, and then you would just type it in your browser screen. So it would by default have the same originating IP address as your entire sign-in. And for example, you could be using a VPN connection on your laptop, which routes your sign-in through your corporate office, for example, while your phone isn't connecting to VPN. So it would have a different IP address or a different region. So no, there's no way to check that. The best way to make sure this doesn't happen is to educate your users, I guess.
Which is probably the hardest thing to do.
Yeah.
I don't see
like
any
always.
Questions, but maybe you can have a look in the chat later on and see if there were some trailing questions that I missed.
Yeah, sure. And like I said beforehand, for everyone, please feel free to reach out on the internet or Twitter or on LinkedIn. And I'll look through the chat on the YouTube channel and answer all questions I see there.
Okay, cool. Flor, we have some questions about the Badger. Can you explain something about our beautiful Badger?
Oh yeah, 100%. So we have a little recognition program. It's called the Azure Heroes. And one of those is the Learner Badge, which is the most, I think, basic badge you can claim. It's the sort of the first in all of your badge claiming activities. It's a blockchain badge, so you can also only get it once. Well, not for the Azure Heroes Learner Badge, but for all of the other ones, they're exclusive. And so you really have to earn your badge, and they're limited as well. And to encourage you all to, you know, stick into the thread and stick to learning, even in these, you know, trying times, we want to give you a Azure Heroes Learner Badge. So you can follow the link that I posted in the chat, and I think later on we'll also have a slide with a QR code that you can scan and claim your Learner Badge for today.
Cool, thank you.
Commercial break?
I think it's time for a commercial break. After the break, we will continue with Eldert Groteboer on this stream, guiding us through all Azure messaging services. So I'm looking forward to that one. If you want to know what other streams are running right now, just surf to azureday.community, and there you can find all the sessions and the live streams. And we hope to see you after the break.